Another week of protest and more pressure on the police. Tracking the week's most impactful local news stories from our biggest newsmakers and moments, all in less than 27 minutes. Stay with us. Your Week in Review starts now.
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gourley, Haas and Wilkerson Insurance, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Good to have you with us again. I'm Nick Haines. It's one big news development after another, and it's hard to keep up, but helping us keep track of it all this half hour, KCUR City Hall reporter Lisa Rodriguez, the managing editor of the Call newspaper, Eric Wesson. By the way, when you see him on screen, he's actually in the newsroom trying to get the newspaper out. He's probably written three stories while he's on the air with us. Coming to us from the underground bunker of Helling headquarters, the Kansas City Star's Dave Helling, and from his office in the Department of Journalism at UMKC, the host of Up to Date on KCUR-FM, Steve Kraske. If you're heading to downtown Kansas City and passing City Hall this week, you will notice an unfamiliar sight, dozens of pitch tents on the lawn just outside. They are part of what is now a round-the-clock protest against police use of force. It follows a viral video that appears to show a Kansas City police officer kneeling on a pregnant woman during an arrest. The protesters say they won't leave the encampment until the Kansas City police chief is removed, the officer involved in the arrest is fired, and 50% of the Kansas City Police Department's funding is reallocated to social service agencies. Lisa Rodriguez, as we record this program this hour, have any of those demands been met?
They haven't, and they won't be, by all indications. The mayor, Kansas City Mayor Quentin Lucas, has said repeatedly that he doesn't think a 50% cut in the police department's budget is realistic. He has not seen any interest among the Board of Police Commissioners to fire Chief Rick Smith, and that he doesn't intend to call for that vote. And, you know, both sides are standing firm here. So this sets up to be a very long showdown, because I don't see either side budging here unless the, you know, police move to forcibly remove protesters or tensions escalate and things don't remain nonviolent.
Well, the mayor is just one figure in our local political scene, Eric Wesson. Are they getting support from any other top elected officials in our community?
Councilwoman Shields and Robinson and Councilman Eric Bunch, I think they were in the mindset that they have a right to do that, and they can be on city property doing that. So I think that, you know, as noble as it seems and it sounds good, I don't think that their demands are realistic, because not only are they asking for the termination of Rick Smith, but any officer that's killed a black man. And looking at the entire video, the lady that Deja was in an altercation, one thing led to another. The next thing I know, in the next part of the video, it shows her on the ground. The policeman had his knee in her back, but she might.
Okay, he's frozen there for a moment. Let me go to Steve Kraske here. The police department says that she was interrupting an arrest. They were trying to make an arrest. She was interfering with that. That is why they felt they had to handcuff her.
That's right, Nick, but this is a very bad look for the Kansas City, Missouri Police Department. All you need to see and look at on this video is the fact that we have a nine-month-old pregnant woman with a nine-month-old baby inside of her, face down on the ground with a police officer over her, kneeling on her back. And that, again, is something that this community needs to come to grips with. That's not the kind of look the Kansas City, Missouri Police Department wants to be about. You know, I agree with everything that's been said here about these protesters, Nick. Their demands are unrealistic. This is not going to end well for them. I think one big question is, how long will city officials and the police department allow them to camp out on the front lawn of City Hall?
But is that being evenly applied? If there was a homeless person pitching a tent on the lawn outside of City Hall, would he or she be moved along? What if these were pro-life activists saying they did not care for abortions in this country? Would they be moved along if they pitched tents there?
Several years ago, I reported on the Occupy movement in Kansas City. You may remember it at Liberty Memorial Park. There was a tent city that went up, and there was some concern in the community that the protesters were staying there overnight and that would be a problem. And my recollection is that that just eventually went away. There was sort of a benign neglect, and the Parks Department said, okay, as long as you pick up trash and stuff, you can stay as long as you want. And it eventually went away. And my guess is that may be what happens at City Hall. Let me just say, though, that of all the demands, I think everyone is right, they're unrealistic, but you could see a path to a compromise on police funding, for example. They want 50%. The mayor's already talking about 11%. So, you know, cuts for the police department might be on the table. What cannot be compromised is Rick Smith. He either stays or goes. And as long as that remains a sticking point, not only with protesters, but with ministers and the Urban League and other people, that's going to be a bit of a grain of sand, if you will, in the shoe of the politics of Kansas City.
But Lisa, you have said many times on this program that there is actually not enough support, though, to get rid of Rick Smith.
So far, all indications from leadership and the Board of Police Commissioners has been that they support their chief. But if this continues to draw out and the protesters do stand their ground, then that of all of the demands may be the easiest and the quickest one to actually meet.
Eric.
It's a bad optic for the police officer having his knee in the back of a pregnant woman, but it's also a bad optic in the process of going through hiring a city manager to have a bunch of tents out and protest on the city hall lawn. Now, if I'm a city manager and I'm like, hey, what's going on here? Do I want to step in the middle of this kind of conflict? And I'm wondering to a great degree why Mayor Lucas has taken so many upfront hits for Chief Smith. Let Chief Smith step to the forefront and take the hits himself. That's his job. That's a part of being the chief of police.
Does anybody have an answer to that question as to why the mayor does that?
It's very common for the mayor to try and find whatever he thinks is the middle ground. So he supports the chief, but he also supports the protesters. He'll make one statement here and another statement there. You know, my colleagues may have a different analysis, but I think the mayor, for good or for ill, always looks for a way out of a dispute in which everybody gets a little bit of something, but nobody gets everything they want. That's why Smith's job, Nick, is so critical to all of this, because you can't split that baby. You're he's either there or not. That's something the mayor hasn't really solved so far, at least.
Well, just days after Mayor Quinton Lucas announced a new plan to fix violent crime in Kansas City, he now wants to hear from you. He's been touring neighborhoods and this week held the first of a series of town halls on violence. This was a virtual town hall taking place on Zoom. What did we learn from this event, if anything, Lisa?
I don't know that we learned that we accomplished a lot in this first event. It was not a very structured town hall, and so it ended up kind of being a free-for-all, covering everything from the mayor's mask mandate to incentive reform in Kansas City. A lot of it focused on the protesters camped outside City Hall. So while it was intended to be a listening session on how we prevent this, on the kind of the prevention aspect of this whole plan, it was kind of all over the board. And so there may need to be a little bit more structure moving forward here. But he certainly heard what was on the mind of Kansas Cityans. I just don't know if it was about crime.
Was there any new fixes offered up by the public, Eric?
In the Black community, the message is still remains the same. And that is that you got to do something to improve the relationship between the police department and the community if there is to be something on crime that changes crime. I commend the mayor for taking some steps toward opening dialogue, but I think he has to have a more narrowed, broad focus rather than just a broad, how do we reduce crime? Because like was said, people come in, start talking about their trash didn't get picked up, tiffs and all kind of things. So I think he's got to structure it a little bit better.
Steve.
You know, well, if that's the case, you know, that the Black community feels the way that Eric Wesson just outlined it, it does raise the question of how much longer this chief should remain in office. I agree with my colleagues. There has been no sign of any movement that the chief is going to go away. But we are 6 or 7 months from the Plaza protest that went so wrong at the beginning. I still wonder if not in the next few months, he might say enough's enough and time to move on, because it appears to me that that's the step that has to happen before this crime fighting agenda can really proceed.
Who could have predicted that in a 48-hour time span, the president of the United States would test positive for COVID-19 and the pandemic would halt the Chiefs from playing at Arrowhead? As players on both teams tested positive for the virus, one of our long-term viewers, Alan in Overland Park, wants to know, how come the Chiefs were able to play a day later when our school districts are forcing hundreds of students to quarantine for 2 weeks when there is one positive case? Is there a contradiction there, or is comparing this the proverbial apples to oranges, Steve?
Well, I think it's a little bit of both, Nick. I mean, you're talking about a private business here, the NFL and the Kansas City Chiefs, versus a taxpayer-supported entity. And there's no question that the NFL is wading into murky waters here with continuing with this season at a time when, you know, they're doing lots of testing. But it's also a fact here that someone can be carrying the virus and still test negative and then infect people and test positive later. We're going to find out with our quarterback how his health is in the next few days. So no question, this is apples and oranges a little bit here, because the NFL is a private business and the school district is a taxpayer-funded entity.
Well, how large a crowd can safely gather at an outdoor event? In the case of the Chiefs, it's apparently been set at 16,000 people. What about at your teenager's football game? That question was scheduled to be debated in court this week in a case brought by the Blue Springs School District. They're angry no more than 100 spectators can gather at their high school football games. The Blue Springs superintendent says it doesn't make sense when they're allowed to have 500 people in their high school theater. Now Jackson County has quietly amended its rules. Starting this weekend, health officials are removing the 100-person cap on outdoor events, just as long as all attendees wear masks, socially distance, and notify the county at least 72 hours in advance of the planned gathering. What is the message we learn from this about turn? Is it that if you complain loud enough about COVID rules, local officials will back off? Or is there another message, Lisa Rodriguez?
Well, I think Jackson County here is falling into line with what the rules are in kind of the surrounding areas. Kansas City doesn't have an outdoor gathering limit. But on the other hand, fighting this and taking this battle to court costs taxpayer money. And this is, we're in a time right now where the county doesn't have a lot of that to spend. It's still spending its federal coronavirus relief money. So I don't know that if it was a fight that was worth the cost.
Now, I know, Eric Wesson, on a previous show, you mentioned that the taxpayer money being used on this, but I see the Blue Springs School District say no. When we filed this suit against Jackson County, this was being paid for by private contributions, charitable contributions. None of it came from taxpayer money. Does that make it better?
No, because it takes taxpayer money to defend it, and the county counselors have to be paid, and the lawyers and the judges have to be paid to review it. So it's still costing taxpayers money, but it just goes to show how when parents come together, when they really want something, that they can push and get it done. And maybe, I hope it's a safe environment. I think the issue is going to be trying to get all parents out there to wear masks, because there's been videos of it happening in other school districts. Parents have been outraged. They're not wearing masks. They've been fighting security guards. So it's been kind of a mess doing that. I just hope they follow the rules.
Steve.
You know, I think the history is going to be fascinating to read someday of how our society has reacted to COVID-19, because the ongoing continuous pushback against restrictions of almost any kind continue. And those who are pushing back against restrictions are winning, Nick, in case after case. And even in the wake of the president's situation with COVID-19, it's an amazing story, it seems to me.
We've been closely watching another legal case this week, a new lawsuit filed by the ACLU to block evictions in Jackson County. The Trump administration recently issued a moratorium preventing landlords from evicting tenants until the end of the year. But the renters group KC Tenants claims that rule is being ignored here. They say nearly 300 of evictions have been filed in the county since that federal moratorium went into effect. So why is Jackson County deciding the president's rule is optional when it comes to this part of the country? Or is there something more to this story that we're missing, Lisa?
I think the county is taking a really broad look at what this order means, and maybe the order was written in a way that allows for that. But the fact is, there are thousands of tenants in Kansas City that have been severely economically impacted by this crisis, and there has been no federal help in sight. There has not been another round of relief, and so this is a really serious issue, and lives are truly at stake here.
This is an amazing mystery, Nick. Right in our midst here, in mid-August, the presiding judge of Jackson County, David Burns, said he would reinstate a moratorium only if the federal government imposed a moratorium. Well, that's happened here, and yet we don't have a resolution to this going forward.
Yeah, can I just throw something in quickly, Nick? I agree with all of this, but it is also fair to say, what about the people who are landlords and expect a revenue stream? And you know, you can't expect people who make their living that way to go without income for month after month after month. The answer is clearly for the government to provide rental assistance to these tenants so they can pay their rent, the landlords will get their money, and everything will be back to normal. The federal government is dysfunctional in that way. They haven't, you know, moratorium is just an intermediary step. The bigger problem is people are unemployed. They need money. They don't have money, and the landlords are suffering as a result. So there's a lot of attention paid to the legalities of all of this, but the real answer is Congress stepping up and providing a revenue stream for these folks so that everyone can sort of make what money they need to make, in my view.
And that's right. But in the meantime, right, lots of people are being kicked out of their homes, and it's not clear why. And that's a crisis for a lot of families that we need to understand why this is happening.
And Eric Wesson, I see, has been kicked off our screen, and we need to understand why. We'll be bringing him back in just a moment.
I'm a jinx, Nick.
I know you are. If you live in Missouri and haven't gotten around yet to registering to vote, well, you're now too late. That deadline expired on Wednesday. If you live on the other side of the state line, you have a little more time. The voter registration deadline for Kansans is Tuesday, October 13th. I've heard a number of news accounts from election officials on both sides of the state line with sort of confident expressions that they are prepared and they're ready for mail-in and in-person balloting. Are they, Dave Helling?
I think that the voting process in Kansas and Missouri will be less confusing than maybe we expected even a month ago. I think it's possible that a lot of people have understood how the mail-in process works, particularly in Kansas, which has no excuse early voting. So I think it may go more smoothly than a lot of people expect. Having said that, Missouri's election laws are really a mess. You know, you have to mail in a mail-in ballot, but you can turn in an absentee ballot at the election headquarters. There are remote sites for voting absentee, but you need an excuse most of the time. People of good faith should sit down next year and fix all of that.
Well, and they're a mess for a reason, as Dave Helling well knows. You know, there are certain people in the state capital of Missouri who want to make voting more difficult to lower turnout. That's seen as an advantage for Republicans. This is an easy fix. Lots of states have figured this out, and yet Missouri continues to struggle through this year after year, election after election, with notary publics and where do you put your ballot, and it's ridiculous.
It seems like please, Lisa.
It's also, you know, it's a fight that's currently in front of a Missouri Supreme Court judge right now, is whether all ballots, regardless of whether they're notarized or not, should be counted and which one aren't. And those arguments happened this week. So there may still be, weeks before an election, confusion as to which votes will count, which one won't. And it really, I mean, great just point. To echo what Dave and Steve have already said, it's a mess.
And speaking of that mess, I see from the Associated Press, a contract driver for the U.S. Postal Service just been accused of opening and destroying mail. The 23-year-old Dennis Tapscott being charged with delaying mail, adding a sense of distrust also about the process of mail-in ballots for this election season. As President Trump declares he's getting ready to rejoin the campaign trail after testing positive for COVID-19, Missouri's governor is already back to hosting in-person events this week. week. Mike Parson says he and his wife have fully recovered from their bout with the virus. While the long-term health implications on his body may be unknown, is there any evidence he paid any price politically, Steve?
You know, I'm not sure there is, Nick. The polls seem to be relatively stable in the race. Governor Parson holding a 5 to 8 point lead, depending on which poll you're looking at. And those numbers really haven't changed pre-COVID for the governor and now post-COVID for the governor. So it seems to be that he's the favorite as we sit here about a month before the election. Something significant, more significant, would have to happen for the dynamics of this race to change dramatically.
Most of the concentration in this election, I think you'll agree, has been obviously on the presidential race with a dab of the Missouri governor's race and a U.S. Senate race in Kansas along the way. What race is of greatest interest to you that isn't getting much attention at this point, starting with you, Dave?
I think that we need to pay close attention in Kansas to state legislative races, Nick. I mean, in the primary, conservative Republicans cleanly swept primaries against moderates. So there's a possibility that the Kansas legislature will be even more conservative in 2021 than it was last year.
Lisa.
I think even locally, in the moment that we're in, they may not be the most competitive races, but the Jackson County prosecutor is facing a challenge this election cycle. And we've seen Gene Peters Baker, the incumbent, charge Kansas City police with aggressive, use of force, even with involuntary manslaughter. And I think that has emotions high. So I think in the moment that we're in, that's a race to watch.
We're not trying to pat ourselves on the back here, but we did do a debate between those two candidates last night, and it's on our YouTube.
I watched it.
On our YouTube channel, so you can see that at Kansas City PBS. Steve Kraske, what did you pick?
Yeah, I would point to the Clean Missouri vote in Missouri, Nick. This is the ethics reform idea that would change the way we do redistricting. Republicans are trying to reject the initiative that voters passed in 2018. It's a little confusing. A yes vote is a vote to reject Clean Missouri. A no vote against the amendment is a vote in support of Clean Missouri. Big decision here.
Let's go through all of those ballot measures next week on the program so we can get to grips with what's happening there. Eric Wesson, just to cue you in here, we're on the election race that isn't getting much attention. You know, we got the presidency and the governor's race in Missouri. Is there a race that you think deserves more attention that it's getting right now?
I have to agree with Lisa. I think the Jackson County prosecutor's race deserves some attention. And she had mentioned that Gene Peters Baker had filed charges against some police officers. But to a lot of people in the black community, that was too much too late. So that's going to be an interesting race to watch.
Now, when you put a program like this together every week, you can't get to every big local story making the headlines. What was the big story we missed? Did the parent protests work? Thousands of middle and high school students, including in Blue Valley, head back to class for the first time in 7 months. A Park Hill principal grabs the headlines for forcing athletes to remove racial unity shirts.
It was extremely embarrassing and disappointing because we were wearing them in unity with North Kansas City, and they had to watch as we took the shirts off.
Students told if they wear them to school, they would also have to allow tops that say KKK and Make America Great Again. She disappeared 9 years ago this week, and her case is still attracting national attention. Yet nearly a decade on, still no answers to what happened to baby Lisa. While Kansas City, Missouri is grabbing the headlines for homicides, KCK battling its own murder wave, homicides up 75%. And rising crime in Johnson County, putting DA Steve Howe on the defensive. He's facing his first election challenge in 12 years.
In Johnson County alone, violent crime has drastically increased. You need somebody who's going to hold these individuals accountable.
I'm really appalled that he starts to make personal attacks on me and my office.
Both candidates debated this week here at the station, along with the Jackson County prosecutor, who is facing her first opponent since she was elected. Both debates now on our YouTube channel at Kansas City PBS. And this week, a Kansan grabbing the spotlight on the big debate stage. No, it wasn't her or him. It wasn't the plexiglass screens or the fly. No, the moderator, who says she never spent a night outside Kansas until she started college. USA Today Washington Bureau Chief Susan Page got her start in journalism, writing for her high school newspaper in Wichita. Was it one of those stories or something completely different, Lisa?
I picked a story that that KCUR shone light on this week about the bishop of the Kansas City St. Joseph Diocese having sent a letter to parishioners urging them to vote in this election for candidates that will protect the right to life, which has kind of stirred controversy in Kansas City's Catholic community as being a thinly veiled urging to vote Republican. So a lot of debate there over whether that was an appropriate thing to do.
Eric Wesson.
The Call newspaper is going into our 101st year with this issue that's coming out tomorrow. And I think that one thing that I think we didn't pay enough attention to was the coronavirus positive test between the Chiefs and the New England Patriots. A lot of people are focused on the fact that the person that had contracted it had came in contact with Patrick Mahomes. But the thing about that is also he tackled a lot of people, too.
That was actually the Chiefs calling you, saying not to mention that on the program, Eric. Steve Kraske.
Well, I picked the rising crime rate in Johnson County in Kansas City, Kansas, Nick. Yes. It's of little comfort to Kansas City, Missouri, that our neighboring communities are experiencing similar problems. But I think it does put all of this in a little bit of context for everybody here.
And Dave Helling.
Well, I think the Johnson County story in the Star about rising home prices was an extraordinarily interesting story to me. In the middle of a pandemic, the idea that home prices are exploding in Johnson County is interesting, but the lack of affordable housing for sort of middle-class wage earners in this county is very troubling, needs to be addressed by local leaders, and they're sort of trying to sweep it under the rug. They won't be able to do that forever.
And on that, we will say our week has been reviewed. Thank you to KCUR's Lisa Rodriguez for checking in with us on the Week in Review mega screen, and to the Call's Eric Wesson, the Star's Dave Helling, and keeping you up to date weekday mornings at 9 on KCUR-FM. Steve Kraske and I'm Nick Haines. From all of us here at Kansas City PBS, keep calm and carry on.